crashing Willie's garage.
Ah! Hey, and welcome to Willie's Garage. I'm Nick, that's George. To recap, I am a huge ALF fan. I have been since the series debuted in September 1986. And George never watched an episode until we started the show, right?
That is correct.
And how are you enjoying so far?
I'm learning a lot about the mid-1980s that I lived through once before and am living through again.
I can't imagine a mid-1980s without ALF, but it's a fascinating exploration.
That's what Gorbachev said, I think.
Well, the main goal of the show, of course, is to get ALF to be on it. That's really the only purpose of it. We want ALF to be on the show. We want it to get so big that ALF and his creator, Paul Fusco, cannot ignore us. So we hope you'll tell a friend about the show. Of course, we're recapping every episode. Today we'll be doing episode 2. But we also show off weird ALF merchandise and products we found from around the world. And I think I wanted to start today by talking a little bit more about Paul Fusco, the creator.
Yeah, so he is from the Connecticut area. And he went, when he was in high school, he became interested in puppeteering and magic and ventriloquism. And here's a show that he was on in the 80s and called Kids Time in Waterbury, Connecticut. This is the early 80s called, this is a promo for...
Hey kids, do you want to be a super character?
Well, it's easy.
Watch Channel 20's Great Kids lineup weekday afternoons between 3 and 5. Now, when you see the super character, get ready for your phone call from Channel 20 and tell us who the correct super character is.
Win a $20 gift certificate, good for toys, games, and a whole lot more to choose from at Kids Stuff.
Every time you win, Wendy's will match the $20 gift so that a needy child can be a winner too.
Get your official entry form at Wendy's or send a postcard with your name, address, and phone number to Super Character WTXX-TV, Waterbury, Connecticut 06702.
Now, to me, that doesn't sound anything like him.
Well, the main thing, though, is the ALF, like, muzzle. Like, the beak
right.
is very similar. A little bit, you can see the tooth there. It's pretty,
yeah.
It's an interesting prototype. It's like seeing an early Kermit the Frog or something.
Yeah, and he also I believe he was the writer for a series of cable short films like this one. This is the Crown of Bog. So let's see if you can hear his voice here.
Idiots! The crown, remember the crown.
Oh yes, yes, thank you, your worthlessness. Return to this kingdom, the original crown of Bog.
What? The crown of Bog?
Are you hearing it?
Yeah.
But that thing's been cursed for years. Everyone who's ever tried to retrieve it has never returned. Besides, it's up there, on the surface, in that old museum.
Anyhow, looks like pretty big budget, and I see what you mean, the tooth. I heard it in the voice. I heard.
Yeah.
So, you know, he had a career going, and clearly this was
You know, the thing I forgot or the thing I didn't realize, I guess, about puppets is that you can't just be the puppeteer. You have to actually be good at making puppets, too. And I know, like, we had Elmo on the show, guy who plays Elmo.
Ryan.
Yeah, Ryan. And he makes his own puppets that are incredible. So you have to learn that, not just, like, how to do the motions and be funny and get the movements and all that. So Paul Fusco, I think, had it all. And we talked about the first episode, the pilot episode of ALF that aired 34 years ago. And I want to talk a little bit about what the critical reaction was, because Tom Shales, who... was the preeminent critic at the time, wrote this after the episode premiered. He said, "ALF doesn't look like a fish. He looks like a Teddy Ruxpin bear that was horribly disfigured by a revolving door." Shots fired by Shales. "The character is not so much cute and cuddly as he is rude and demanding. He's a snotty Muppet." I mean, that sounds like a selling point to me.
Right.
When he tells his host he wants a snack and they ask him what kind, he asks, "Have you got a cat?" Still, ALF himself is funny enough to keep the show bubbling. He's a sardonic insouciance. So, I mean, he's using insouciance in a review about ALF. That's how you know you're a television critic. You got what it takes.
I mean, I agree with him all around.
In terms of the insouciance?
It is very sardonic. Especially the Insouciants.
That is some of the most sardonic Insouciants I've seen.
On network TV, anyway.
So Shales liked it. They got the Shales stamp of approval for the premiere. Let's play a promo. I meant to play this last week, but this is a promo that aired on the Sunday Night Movie on NBC before it premiered on Monday.
NBC Sunday Night at the Movies will return following these messages.
We now join the ALF press conference in progress.
Yeah, you're with the Chief Toupee.
Is there anything you'd like to ask us?
Yeah. Why did you guys cancel Star Trek?
Oh, what do you think of pornography?
I don't know. I don't even own a pornograph.
Oh, good joke.
ALF, are you going to pose nude?
I am nude.
So, I mean, you can see, it's weird that some of those jokes are pretty adult, but the show, I think, maybe they didn't realize how much of a kid following it would have, because we talked about he drinks beer, he's a little more loutish at the beginning.
Right, and here's Paul Fusco, I believe, filming that.
That's from that. Yeah. Wow. So. Looks very young there. Yeah. Well, let's get into the second episode, which is entitled Strangers in the Night. And this starts, I guess, after the pilot, every show after that has a song title or a play on a song title as the title of the episode, which I didn't realize. But and of course, before the internet, no one really cared about what shows were titled. It was just what you put on the front of a script. So for episode two, let's do a Melmac recap. Strangers in the Night. We'll see why it was called that. This one is directed by a guy named Peter Boners, just when I saw that in the IMDb, I was like, his poor middle school existence, you know?
I have to imagine it's Boners.
No, George, I think you're saying it incorrectly.
Okay. Right. I choose to say Boners.
It's definitely Boners. Peter Boners. Okay. And it turns out he was an actor, too. He was on the Bob Newhart show. He played the orthodontist. And he's from Milwaukee, and he played Jerry Robinson on the Bob Newhart show. And co-creator of ALF, Tom Patchett, also was a writer on Bob Newhart. So I think that might have been the connection. He ended up directing a lot of Friends episodes as well.
Well, he also was in, if you're like me, a very
Go ahead and say buff, George. Go ahead.
No, I wanted to say snob. If you're a film snob, you would know him from the movie Medium Cool from, I believe it was 1969, one of my favorite movies.
Yeah.
A very cinema verite, very not ALF. and there was one thing I wanted to address from last week. I said I wasn't sure whether it was a laugh track or not, but I found in one place it's definitely a laugh track, as you suggested, that it was all filmed over several days and patched together. And when listening through headphones, you can clearly tell it's a laugh track.
Oh, yeah, because you hear the same types of laughs come through. And
yeah.
It definitely was. I think, like, there weren't a lot of laughs on the set either, so they needed all the help they could get.
Right.
Let's talk about this episode. And the plot is that Willie has to go into work. Lynn and Kate, I think, have a wedding shower, a baby shower. And so they lock ALF in a bedroom, so Mrs. Achmonic, the neighbor, can babysit Brian, who's just going to sleep. I don't know if Brian's even in the episode besides the beginning.
And he appears when I think she opens the door and sees him asleep at one point.
That's right. Yeah. But this is Mrs. Achmonic. This is where you really get to know the nosy neighbor a little bit more. And who might be one of my favorite characters, Mr. Achmonic. He steals the show. So ALF just wants to watch Brian alone and watch Psycho is playing on the local station. But instead, they get Mrs. Achmonic babysit. So let's take a look at the first clip, which is the first utterance of the ALF catchphrase, I kill me.
And we're going to be late for the shower.
Has anybody seen the yellow ribbon?
I don't know. What color is it? Ha! Yeah, I kill me.
Ha! You kill me.
Well, no arguments. It's time to get ready for bed, Kay.
Well, sorry, Alf. Well, guess what? Wait, later.
Oh, wait. Here's that ribbon, but it's wet.
Forgot to tell you, you're out of floss.
Maybe there's a chance I can find some ribbon without meat on it.
Not in that drawer.
I might have some meatless ribbon in the garage.
Forget the ribbon. A blender doesn't need ribbon. Okay, you have Joanna's number, right?
We won't have any problem. Brian's going to bed. I've got a lot of reading to catch up on, and I'm sure Alf will find something to do.
Make sure he doesn't.
Oh, I'll get it.
Hey, don't worry about the old Alfer. Gentle Nine's running Psycho.
Okay, so yeah, they're going to show Psycho on TV. That's what he wanted to do, is sit there and watch that. So the first utterance of I Kill Me, pretty historic.
Yeah, I know where I was when I first heard it, and it was sitting right here yesterday.
You hadn't heard that catchphrase before?
No, but I guess I didn't hear it in context in the first time.
I'm wondering, why that was so funny, because I guess, you would say about a comedian, oh, he kills me, or I killed that night. So he kills himself, basically.
Right. He's in his own world. He's commenting on his own comedic talents. He's separate from everything else.
Now, grammatically, would it be I kill myself, or is I kill me correct?
Well, the idiom, I think grammatically, yes, but I kill myself has a different meaning.
Right. The show would have been even darker at that point.
Right. And one of the things I loved in this was, and you're probably going to talk about this, that Psycho is playing in the background the whole time, but they clearly didn't get the rights to the music.
No.
So they have their version.
I didn't actually include any of that, but yeah, you can hear they're it's like that, but it's not quite the same.
Yeah, it's two notes, but it's two different notes.
Yeah.
It's
just enough to get away with it. So the ALF, they bring over Mrs. Akmonik to watch Brian. Alf is locked in the bedroom, and at one point he dials and orders a pizza, and the pizza comes. Mrs. Akmonik gets suspicious and calls in her husband, Mr. Akmonik, who's across the street watching the Dodgers. But here's Mr. Akmonik checking things out.
I'm going in. If I don't come back, you can start dating.
I've already tried it. It's locked. Now it's open.
What are you, narrating this?
Stay! Willie even told me to stay out of this room. Look in the bathroom.
Oh, for crying out loud. Hey!
Trevor, what is it?
They got one of them cushion toilet seats. Let's get one, Raquel. I'm tired of living in the dark ages.
Just check the window, will you?
I laughed hard at that, cushion toilet seat joke. I really did. We're getting one. I'm tired of living in the dark ages. It's good stuff.
Well, the Akmonik's marriage is, to me, very depressing. It was a staple of 80s TV shows. Everything from in the 70s, I guess, from the Ropers to the Bundys. That marriage, to me, growing up, I thought, well, marriage is you're being sentenced to boredom and hating each other, but you're stuck together.
Yeah, my thought was always, why don't they get a divorce if they really dislike each other that much?
Yeah, and John LaMotta, who played Trevor Akmonik, said, and I quote, "I thought the show ALF was a piece of shit. Worst work I ever did."
Disagree. I thought he might have been phoning in that character, but some good stuff in that opening. And Mrs. Akmonik is played by Liz Sheridan. I did some homework on her. She was an old nightclub singer and Broadway actress who, following Alf, of course, she played Jerry's mother, Helen, for however many seasons Seinfeld was on. So she went on to a long career after that and had a storied career before it. And then, of course, hijinks continue. Alf gets out of the bedroom. He goes out to meet the pizza guy, and the window closes, so Alf can't get the pizza. And a burglar comes in, and here's more adventures with the burglar.
I was scared stiff, but I knew I had to do something. I realized for that moment, I was the man of the house.
Also, by the way, he's narrating. In the first episode, Willie narrated it. This one, Alf narrates it.
Right. And that's in keeping with the network notes that this show has to be as much Alf as possible all the time.
Yeah.
Excuse me, sir. May I have a word with you?
Who said that?
I did. Can you take some constructive criticism? What you're doing here is wrong.
Alf was trying on one of a dress, I think, from Lynn. Oh, sorry, it was Kate's dress because he's in the parents' bedroom.
Yeah, you would have heard all about that in the comments.
I know.
And them talking dolls.
Oh, yeah? Ever have a talking doll rip out your voice box?
That's like cartoon. Like, who would jump out of a window like that?
Yeah, there's not much, I guess, verisimilitude that was attempted starting throughout the...
Also, a talking doll, I mean, it was kind of prophetic because there would be a Coleco talking elf doll just a couple of years later.
It's merchandising beginning to end.
Exactly. And that actor, I was like, what do I know him from? I've seen him in a lot of stuff. His name's Larry Hankin. He was in Breaking Bad. He works all the time. He was in Buried most recently. But the thing I knew him from was that in the Seinfeld episode, the pilot, where they're making the show Seinfeld in Seinfeld, he plays Kramer. And right. I was like, yes, that's exactly who it is. It's just kind of that distinctive face. So he's pretty good. We might be able to get him on a future show. And I don't know how much he has to talk about with the burglar, being a burglar on an episode of ALF. But so the burglar turns himself in, and the last line, they give back the jewelry that he stole, and ALF's last line heard from the other room is, "Can somebody unzip me in here?" And because he couldn't get out of the dress.
Right.
So pretty good. You got some world building with the Akmonics, and it kind of set the template for the family leaves, ALF gets into misadventures.
Right, and I think there was some great interplay between the person in the suit whose name escapes me at the time.
Michu.
At the moment. Okay.
He was a circus performer, yeah.
Right, and the puppet. There was a scene in which ALF ran into the kitchen behind like a kitchen island or something and then pops up, and it was great. It was a great simulation of object permanence.
Yeah, it didn't occur to me maybe until like three seasons in that he never talked while he was moving, because they had to swap out. And that's why the show took 3 days to shoot one 22-minute episode. But pretty good episode. I had a lot of laughs with Trevor Akmonic in that episode. And so that's episode two, and that's the Melmac recap. And of course, my favorite part of the show is where we get to show off all the ALF crap we've discovered on the internet and in person. All right, first of all, I want to show that people are already writing in. We got dozens and dozens of emails after the first episode of the show. So unfortunately for George, I think it's here to stay. we got one. Mortimer James on Twitter, I think her name's Melissa, sent me this. She has which looks like a lunchbox from Germany. No Problemo was his catchphrase in Germany. Of course, we've established that ALF was huge in Germany. I say, of course. No one should know this stuff. But,
I mean, if Falco was big in Germany, ALF was big in Germany.
So, and then that gave me the notion that all my ALF crap that I'm going to show on today's show is going to be German ALF merchandise. So, Mortimer, James, Melissa, thanks for sending in that. What do you have, George?
Okay, well, the first thing I found is something that I think you will greatly enjoy. Oh. These are ALF Rocks shoes from 1987. These are currently $250 on eBay. It's a girl's size 3.
So I'd really have to squeeze. I'd really have to do like Chinese foot binding to do it, right. But it might be worth it.
Yeah, the photoplasty that you need to wear these. You need them because they have, you fold them down and they have ALF in the back. They've got these. This is them.
That's how I
fold it back up. And with the ALF patch, it says ALF on the interior, and the that decal is this ALF Rocks image that was apparently very popular at the time.
Whoa, I've never seen that shirt. That's
also
great.
On eBay.
I like how furry he is in that, and the drawing looks a little off. It doesn't look like it should have been officially licensed, but I think like early Simpsons merchandise, they just kind of, they're like, hey, strike while the iron's hot. Let's just throw stuff against the wall and see what sticks. And that was the case with some other stuff. And these are German ALF releases on VHS that were sent, I believe Bob Hedges, who's a viewer of VCR Party, sent me these. So there's two releases, and one of them has the pilot that we watched last week, and one of the scenes that we watched last week. So I wanted to show off that what that sounded like in German, because the German guy who dubbed Alf's voice in German became a star in his own right in Germany and would release albums as German Alf and had like top 10 hits in Germany. So here's where all that star power started.
Ich habe gesagt, keine Limonade.
Es ist keine Limo, es ist Bier.
Es ist fast kein Bier mehr da.
Was?
What?
Gib das sofort her.
Aber Vorsicht, meins ist noch fast voll.
Also jetzt hör mir mal zu, Alf. Ich werde dein Benehmen in diesem Haus nicht mehr dulden. Dieser Junge ist gerade 6 Jahre alt. Er darf noch kein Bier trinken. Und du solltest auch keins trinken. Ich weiß ja nicht, wie es dazugeht auf deinem Morg oder wie der Planet heißt, von dem du kommst, aber ich...
Melmark.
Was?
Melmark. Das ist der Name von meinem Planeten. Außerdem war das seine Grundsubstanz.
Was soll das heißen, wahr?
Naja, das ist es ja gerade, Kate. Ma'am. Mit Melmark ist es vorbei.
Also, Moment. Willst du damit sagen, du kannst zu deinem Melmark nicht mehr zurück?
Er ist explodiert. Das hier war mein Haus.
That was my street, I think, was the what it was in English. So
yeah, das war ausgezeichnet. We're not going to do the rest of this in German?
No, I
oh,
no.
Okay.
Oh, were you about to? Yo, sorry.
Yeah,
yeah, I didn't mean to.
Well, I thought it was interesting that Alf said he let's see. I believe
do you speak
he's
German?
Not,
do you understand German?
Ein bisschen. Na ja.
Really?
Yeah. But so she said that he was 6 years old here, not 9, which he was in the...
Oh,
in
interesting.
The,
why would they I don't make know, that change?
Probably because you can drink beer at 9.
Yeah, right. And they said lemonade. I don't know if that was what it was in the original. I can't remember. What do these say, George?
Well, hello, I am Alf, and that one is... that means, I think it's like happy trip or vacation, maybe.
Oh, that makes sense. Yeah. Mm. All right. Well, I need to leverage. I just learned something new about you, George. This is going to really be an asset to the show. what else do you have?
Oh, well, here is last week I showed a video game, and here is an educational video game,
wow.
Add and Subtract with Alf. This is for the IBM, but I believe I have, I can show you what it looked like I believe this was the Commodore 64. And I don't think, I'm not sure if there's sound here in the actual game, but that's
a little bit.
Yeah. So I love, so you have that sums has an apostrophe incorrectly.
Yep.
This is, it, apparently there were a series of extremely quickly made, very low budget ALF games, it like the one we saw last week, and they are terrible. I can let me see if I can.
I don't know. That looks like a AAA title to me.
Yeah. So there's some there's some graphics, but if you look, this whole thing is like 4 minutes, but nothing happens. So here's, you know, you have some okay graphics.
Okay. Yeah.
But that's about it. This is I'm playing this now. This is
I believe he's in Willie's garage right there, isn't he? It looks like
yes,
he is. So.
Yes. Yeah. Well, there's the telescope. So that's
wow.
Another piece of nice ALF crap.
Yeah, I downloaded an like a version of an ALF printer software that you could have, which I think it'd be fun to actually print stuff out on that for friends. So I'm gonna actually try that out maybe for the coming weeks. The last thing I wanted to show was somebody sent me this a while back, but it was a series from a German clothing catalog. So, you know, there's ALF clothing in the United States, but it was just for little kids. They had like teen and young adult ALF clothing here. So you can see here that this woman's wearing a denim I Love ALF skirt.
Look, you're bearing the lead here. I want to talk about the eyebrows.
Absolutely.
Are those ALF eyebrows?
Yeah, right. They're okay. Like, let's get her to model for it. Here's more ALF denim, I Heart ALF jeans, and a whole jumper, it looks like. Or maybe that's a denim shirt.
You own none of these, is that right?
No. Okay. But
not yet.
Here's some evening wear, some like pajamas you can wear in ALF, and some more denim. I like the I Heart ALF with ALF with the flowers. That's pretty cool. I mean, look at this. Here's Alf in a director's chair and Alf Holidays. So Germany, they did it right. They, I mean, everybody had Alf fever, but nowhere more than in Germany.
But this is West Germany. I'm pretty sure East Germany did not have Alf fever.
No, probably not. One more thing. Somebody sent me this in the mail. Who was it? Jamie sent me this in the mail, and I just have to show it because it is too incredible not to feature. Look at this hat. This
wow.
arrived without any explanation. I've never seen this before on eBay or anywhere else, but this is like a mint condition ALF hat. And if you think I'm not going to be wearing this in next week's episode, you do not know me very well at all. So thank you to Jamie for your generosity. That is an amazing, and it fits too. So
right, and the ALF eyebrows again, in keeping with the catalog.
Exactly. Do you have any more ALF crap?
I have ALF crap to last 102 episodes, but here is this is an ALF tattoo from a website of the worst tattoos ever. It's ALF Batman.
ALF man.
Yeah. So this is not you, right?
This is not me, but okay. I was a big fan of both properties in the 80s. So,
okay. Well, have you thought about combining them in your private or personal life?
I hope my ALF fandom doesn't get to the point where I'll get a tattoo, but who knows? I mean, we got 100 – we probably have 150 more episodes of this show, so it's going to be a long, long time. All right. You have no choice in the matter, George. That's ALF crap. Let's get on to some updates. First of all, we had a contest last week. We were giving away this, which is my lawyer and friend Anderson took some ALF sheets, curtains, and made a court, pandemic face mask out of this, double layered and everything. The prompt that we gave was name a fictional ALF catchphrase, one that sounded like it should have been a catchphrase, but wasn't. We got probably 30 or 40 entries to this, and we each picked our favorite three, and we both had one in common, and so that's the one that I'm going to declare the winner. But some great runner-ups were Holy Mel Mackerel, pretty good, by Jamie S. I'm Big in Germany, by Joe H. What is it with this planet? I forgot who did that one, but
Jeremiah.
Jeremiah did that one, yep. And I tell you, that guy is one tote bag short of a pledge drive, Joe B. That one just sounds like a line from the show,
right?
Not necessarily one that would have been a catchphrase. But the one that, sometimes the simplest ones are the ones that stick, like no problem. This one is "I Gotta Be Me" by Lewis. So congratulations, Lewis. You've won yourself an ALF face mask. Thanks for everybody who entered. And we got a new contest this time. This is going to be for a bunch of ALF merchandise. Just trust me, it's going to be good. There'll be some unopened decks of ALF trading cards, some other ALF items. But it's Halloween month. So this month, what I want you to do is, you have basically until October 27th at noon, that's a Tuesday, to draw or Photoshop or even wear an ALF costume that combines two properties. So let me give you an example. This is one that I hopped into Photoshop today and put together this. One idea is ALF Macchio. So, you could do ALF Cramden. You could do Alfonso Ribeira, the host of America's Funniest Videos. I just did this on Photoshop, but you can wear a costume, make a costume for Halloween. The best either ALF art, Photoshop, or costume will win a huge grand prize. There'll be some runner-up prizes too. Send those to me personally at nick@foundfootagefest.com. I don't want to clog up Joe's inbox with this. So good luck to everybody. George, anything going out? We got next week, we're going to be talking about a cat-based episode. This is an episode based on Lucky, the family cat. You are definitely allergic to cats.
Fatally.
So I don't know if you'll even be able to watch this one with me. Oh, plus the weirdest ALF item I've ever seen anywhere next week.
Whew. I have to wait a week?
I know. Thanks for joining us in Willie's Garage. We'll see you next week.
Come crashing Willie's Garage.